An odorless, colorless gas, methane enters the atmosphere as leaks from natural gas production, but also from agriculture and natural sources like melting permafrost. The oil and gas industry has long treated methane leaks as an unavoidable hazard. But saving all that methane could be one of the fastest and most effective ways to fight climate change, while also conserving valuable natural gas.
So here you see a retractable tower, and at the top of the tower is a laser spectrometer.
Caroline Alden is co-founder and chief scientist of LongPath Technologies, a tech startup with a new way of detecting those methane leaks with laser-based sensors. Here in the Wyoming sagebrush steppe, near the foothills of the Wind River Mountains, pronghorn antelope and wild horses roam above one of the largest natural gas reserves in the United States. And the Jonah Field has become a proving ground for cutting-edge technology.
So the laser is going around collecting all its concentration data right up there in that little tiny box. And inside that box is a laser, a detector, and all the computing that you need to crunch the numbers on emissions from any of the well sites you can see around here.
This is a kind of a fun place to be as a climate scientist, because it's a place we can all kind of row in the same direction. The industry also, you know, doesn't want to have methane emissions. This is their product that we're keeping in the pipeline for them when we catch leaks. And so it's a real win-win, where if we can give them data to help them make their operations better while also reducing emissions, that's a win-win for the climate and the industry.
In 2022, the U.S. emitted around 6 billion metric tons of greenhouse gases. Methane made up about 11% of that, but it's a particularly potent and toxic gas.
Methane as a molecule is interesting because compared to CO2, which is the greenhouse gas folks are most familiar with, it's about 80 times more powerful in terms of the warming potential on a molecule per molecule basis.
Its potency makes the market for methane detection technology that much more important. And JP Morgan projects it will be more than $900 million by 2025, with a potential global market as high as $14.9 billion.
I believe this is really going to fundamentally change how operators view leak detection and repair. And I think it will change how regulators view leak detection and repair.
Howard Dieter, Jonah Energy's vice president in charge of environmental health and safety, says his goal is 24/7 monitoring using LongPath's continuous laser system, and then following up using optical gas imaging cameras and validating those measurements with drones, aircraft, and satellites.
I do think that as this technology becomes better, as it becomes more affordable to deploy, that it really is a game changer in how we think about operating and managing our facilities.
How has the whole process of detecting methane emissions changed?
So historically, the way leak detection and repair has worked, and even the way the EPA regulations and state regulations work, you're obligated to do a certain inspection once a quarter or once every 6 months or once a year. And in the intervening time, you may have a leak. And so the next time you have a chance to see that leak would be, you know, 85 days, you know, following when that leak started. We're really at the precipice of moving from a schedule-driven leak detection and repair program, whether it's quarterly or semi-annually, to an actual data-driven leak detection and repair program. So we're able to roll an operator out to a site when we have something going on that they need to fix. And we fix the vast majority of things we find at the time we find them, which really reduces the time in which a leak is occurring.
Dieter recalls how a recent leak response team was dispatched to fix an outside contractor mistake at one of Jonah's production facilities.
How did you first find out about it?
Through the dashboard from LongPath. So they picked it up within the laser system. We got a notification. There was a cap on the top that hadn't been fit back, and so there was venting that was coming out of that. So within 3 hours of it being detected, noticed, we found it and fixed it.
It's product in the pipe. So every leak that we catch, it's not just reducing emissions of methane to the atmosphere, it's keeping their product in the pipe.
President Trump has made no secret about the importance he places on U.S. energy production.
We will drill, baby, drill.
But those concerned about the climate warn about the dangers of increasing methane emissions and their effect on the planet.
Police department, evacuate immediately!
Leaks are the problem with methane all around the world. Methane is 20 to 80 times more damaging than CO2, David, so it has a profound impact in adding the amount of methane in the air.
In 2023, U.S. production topped 20 billion cubic feet a day, raising the risk of more leaks and venting. New satellite technology reveals intentional emissions and hidden leaks, making it possible to shine a light on those responsible.
Now we have satellites as well, looking around the globe. What potential effect could that have actually in highlighting places in the globe and even particular producers perhaps that are really having substantial problems with ethane emissions?
It definitely has increased awareness of things that are going on. Within the Oil and Gas Methane Partnership, the International Methane Emissions Observatory started a program called MARS, Methane Alert and Response System, and all of the Oil and Gas Methane Partnership signatories participate in that. And so we get the benefit of IMEO sending us alerts on something that's going on. So it's an extra set of eyes. And on one hand, it can be somebody kind of looking over your operations, but on the other hand, it can give you actionable data at certain levels.
Still, many operators show little sense of urgency, some pointing to difficulties in capturing the leaking methane and transporting it. Others say the economics just don't work to deploy monitoring systems across thousands of sites.
Is Jonah an outlier? I mean, you've been an early adopter. What are the attitudes within the industry? What are the various thoughts about the reaction to methane emission regulations?
We have really top-notch professionals that are experts in their fields. They like the energy industry. They believe in the energy industry, the oil and gas energy industry. They absolutely want to do the right thing. From a methane standpoint, what's interesting, Jonah was the first U.S. company to sign on to the Oil and Gas Methane Partnership in November 2020 when it was formed. And now there's over 20 U.S. companies, including majors and, you know, the largest natural gas producers in the U.S. that have signed on to that partnership. I think what we're seeing is a growing recognition that we have the ability to do this work. We have the ability to demonstrate that we produce natural gas in a very, very efficient way, and we can do it in a way that meets these regulations.
As much as people sign up for it, are they changing their behavior because of that signing up?
They are changing their behavior. Companies are using the data and information that we're collecting through this partnership and the framework in order to really understand their emissions, to deploy capital, to reduce emissions, and to position themselves really well in the market.
Environmental health and safety makes me think about past history with safety in the workplace. And we had OSHA regulations, Occupational Safety Health Administration. And it really, I think, changed a lot of American industry and the safety of workers on the premises. Do you hope and expect something similar to happen when it comes to methane emissions?
I think we're already there. A lot of the foundational change that we saw in the 70s with how safety culture changed. Methane emissions is about changing culture, and it's about helping people understand that business as usual isn't where we need to be anymore. It's not what's expected. Even when you look at the younger workforce, if we were killing two people a year, they wouldn't want to work here. You wouldn't want to work for a company like that. And it's the same way with emissions. If you're not continuously improving how you operate and understanding and utilizing new tools that come out, data-driven tools, then you're not attracting the best and brightest talent. People aren't going to want to work for you, and people aren't going to want your product.
As a climate scientist, are you hopeful that we actually will make some of those targets that are out there for reducing methane emissions?
I think the thing that makes me most hopeful is actually seeing that the driver for folks to use Long Path to reduce emissions from oil and gas, it's not necessarily just because it's the right thing to do. It's because the market drivers are evolving to push this kind of thing. It's not because the regulations are forcing you to. It's because the market is asking you to. And that makes me hopeful as a climate scientist to say, we're getting the flywheel rolling now, that this is how we need to operate in a new world, and we need to track emissions, and that's good for business.